Okay, welcome everyone to the Northwestern Mutual Data Science Institute's Impact Professional Speaker Series. My name is Michelle Featherston. I am the Data Literacy and Culture Program Lead here at Northwestern Mutual. Very excited to be moderating this panel discussion today about the revolution of data science curriculum at UWM and Marquette. So thank you all for joining us this afternoon. So again, our speakers today, we're going to have a panel of four affiliated faculty members from our partner institutions. We have Dr. Larry Hsu, who is an assistant professor of strategic communication at Marquette University. We have Dr. Michael Zimmer, who is an associate professor of computer science at Marquette University. We have Dr. Suzanne Boyd, who is an associate professor and chair of the Department of Mathematics at University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. And we have Dr. Ramila Singh, who is an associate professor in the Department of Management at University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee. So we have a series of questions we are going to take our panel through to discuss, and then we welcome your questions. We will put some questions from the audience out to the panel at the end. Real quick overview on the NMDSI, if you are joining us for the first time or aren't familiar. Our mission, we're a unique partnership between Northwestern Mutual, University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee, and Marquette University. And our vision is to be a world-class institute that transforms our world through the power of data science. And again, it's a unique partnership that trying to bring together the brightest minds in the Milwaukee area to solve some of our world's most pressing problems. Help our community through the power of data science, build a strong talent pipeline for data science in the region, and also produce internationally recognized data science research. So it's a pretty great program. Again, I've already introduced our speakers very briefly. Here they are in photo form. And without further ado, let's get into our questions. So I will stop sharing my screen so that you can see our panelists a little bit better. So my first question for the group, and I'll ask to hear from somebody at each university on these things. But the first one is, tell me a little bit about what the programs at your campus look like that are either data science specific, data science adjacent. If somebody wants to learn more about data science, what are some of the options they have at your school?
We need like a clicker, like on Jeopardy.
Yeah,
that's true.
Why don't you go ahead, Suzanne?
I'll ask. Suzanne has some great examples to share.
All right. So, and then if I forget anything, Dr. Singh can jump in. So at UW-Milwaukee, we have, I would say, a variety of curriculum offerings depending on the place that the student is at in their career and interests. We just started last spring a bachelor's of science degree in data science, joint with the computer science and mathematics departments. So that'd be a complete bachelor's of science, very comp sci, math heavy, methodologically based. We're also going to be rolling out next fall a bachelor of science in data analytics, which is joint between actually many schools and colleges on campus. It's very interdisciplinary. So that'd be another bachelor of science, but more focused on applications. And it's really this sort of unique, very interdisciplinary program. We also are going to be rolling out a Master's of Science in Data Science, which is also interdisciplinary. And that's going to be, because it's very interdisciplinary, accessible to students from a wide variety of backgrounds. You could have done our Bachelor's of Science in Data Science, or you could have done an undergraduate degree in art. And then there would be a few foundational courses you'd have to take before starting the Master's degree in Data Science. Shy of formal degrees, various schools and colleges on our campus have undergraduate and undergraduate certificate programs in data science or data analytics that are more concentrated on their particular applications. Our School of Continuing Education has a data science certificate track for working professionals looking to upskill. And we're even starting to roll out some smaller things for schools and colleges like badges. Like Lubar is rolling out a badge in data science, a citizen badge. So that's what I can think of at the moment. Other than that, there's lots of just individual classes that students can take that relate to data science and analytics. Too many to list right now.
On the Marquette side, we have an undergraduate interdisciplinary data science degree that's run jointly from math and statistics department and computer science. That was launched in 2017. I think there were already like 20 students that took it right at that time, and that's doubled in size since then. We also offer a number of graduate programs. We just launched a master's in data science through the computer science program. This fall is our first cohort. In that program, our master's in computing has had a big data component for a specialization for quite a while. And we also have similar cross-campus, certificates and different analytics programs. We have a shorter data science graduate certificate that I run out of computer science, but we also have our criminal justice program, health sciences, accounting analytics, sports analytics, and more programs across campus that are offering either formal graduate level programs or certificates. And then we're starting to see it creep into more courses and more programs as well, just like Dr. Boyd was saying.
Excellent. So it sounds like there's lots of options, regardless of, where you started, your background, what previous education you have or don't have. There's lots of ways to study data science in some form at both campuses. And that's really exciting to see. I'm wondering if you all could talk about any emerging overarching trends that you're seeing in terms of curriculum, whether it's within the university that's informing changes, changes in enrollments, interests, or even broader changes in what you're seeing feedback from industry that's informing the work that you're doing. And I'm going to flip it. I know, Michael, you just talked, but let's have Marquette answer this one first. So Michael or Larry, if you want to chime in.
I think I can add, because Dr. Zimmer just mentioned several things. I feel that we are exploring the application of data science in very specific areas. For example, we have an online master's program in healthcare and data analytics. And one of the good things about that is it allows students to do dual enrollment in the program, so they can get their degree in healthcare and data analytics, but they can also get a data science certificate. And another program focuses on sports and exercise analytics that intersects physiology, biomechanics, and data science, and as well as criminology, data analytics. So I think we are seeing more interdisciplinary programs that are not purely data science, but teach data science in very specific ways.
Yeah, it's just what I was thinking as well, that in terms of some of the feedback we've been getting or seeing how things have evolved, even in this short time, it's that push to be more interdisciplinary. And a lot of these programs use a handful of computer science courses sort of as the core, but even in those courses, trying to make sure that we're keeping space for these different kinds of perspectives and applications of data science to be able to sort of succeed in that coursework. And I think we've reacted to that and responded well to that, but that is where that interdisciplinary focus really is the current pressure.
Likewise, at UWM, we have a variety of courses that we offer across different schools and colleges that are cross-listed, that allow people to have that interdisciplinary perspective, because our belief fundamentally is that the life is full of complex problems and that requires multiple perspectives to solve them. Similar to Marquette, we've had a longstanding program in healthcare informatics. We have had data science, data analytics, those kind of quantitative data literacy, quantitative skills, borrowing Michelle's word of data literacy over here. We have that embedded in each and every program, and with different levels of skills that we are offering to our students, whether you are a returning student, again, with no experience in the background, but you are curious about this field, we have something for you. And the idea, again, is that we are working very closely with the industry partners. We are also working very closely with the federal and the granting agencies to find out where are the next big things coming up and how is it that we can train our students, our current workforce in a way, to also make sure that they have those kind of cutting edge skills to be successful, whether it's academic life or also being successful as citizens in this world and in our communities. And the whole impetus really is, if I can summarize in one simple phrase, which is making data-driven decisions. So we are really embedding data in any shape and form, from the skills that you use for data analysis to really synthesizing the data to visualizing the data, making those decisions based off of data rather than just on, you know, gut feelings or anecdotes. So each and every school, each and every program, each and every discipline now has some flavor of data science and data analytics. It's just a question of what's driving you, and then using that as a funnel to really go and explore that, knowing that you can take different type of courses from different places to, you know, get that kind of like a frame to your own subject matter expertise.
Wonderful. So it sounds like both places, again, it's not studying data science for the sake of data science. It's studying data science to apply it to all kinds of different things going on in our world, different contexts, different interests. It's really embedded in everything that we do. It also, I will say, makes makes the concept of data science sound more accessible, I think, to a student. My high school self, I'm thinking back to my high school self cringing in the corner and begging to be allowed to drop statistics because I was so lost and didn't understand how does this fit in my life. So those interdisciplinary ties, I think, are really powerful and valuable.
I just really quickly, we'll just sort of, I feel like this conversation is reaching an arc. So I just wanted to add that while we have a lot of formal degree programs, so if you're asking about curriculum trends, you know, not only we're starting for degree programs, but there's a certain number of courses that include, you know, data science, data literacy, but that's certainly growing. And that, like Dr. Singh said, nearly all degree programs have students doing courses like this to their level of appropriateness. And even existing programs are somewhat shifting in this area. So a good example that I'll mention here, because it's Northwestern Mutual, is our department has an actuarial science degree program, which is very popular. And the Society of Actuaries, the big professional organization, just released new, they're going to be revising their curriculum, they're revising their exams, they're going to shift their focus more towards analytics. They're even changing one of the very fundamental first three exams. So that, and probably a lot of people on this call already know about that, but it's just an illustration of how, how data science is really, permeating, all aspects, of what we do.
Yeah, definitely. Sort of related, I think, to what you stated. I'm wondering about what kind of, in some cases, feedback, but maybe in some cases, input, since some of these programs are fairly new. What kind of input or feedback are you getting from students and faculty in other areas that might not be, you know, working in data science yet? What are they saying? What are they giving you to work with to help move these programs forward? Oh, and I got to pick a school. Let's start with UWM on this one.
Dr. Boyd, you want to take that on and I can add to that, or you want me to go? Okay. We have had in the last few years, our chancellor has really pushed for an interdisciplinary focus and the new vision or the I won't say the new vision because it's a few years old, but the vision really is towards solving problems which require the interdisciplinary perspective. With that in mind, when we have big projects, when we have research that we're working on, even at the dissertation committee level and also co-teaching classes at the undergraduate and master's level, there's a growing emphasis in having multiple sets of eyes, multiple sets of perspectives. And the idea here is, again, we are infusing and enriching our curriculum by crossing the aisle, crossing across different schools, reaching out to our colleagues, and trying to combine as many different perspectives and offering those opportunities to our students, because we believe that this is what's going to make them better decision makers using those multiple perspectives for data. In terms of industry partnerships, many of our schools and colleges, subject matters, whether it's accounting or finance or some of those, have boards where we have industry professionals really present their immediate concerns and long-term concerns in terms of this is what the nature of the profession is going to be. And that we use that to inform our structure of our courses and some of those tools and techniques that we would be using in the classroom. So there's multiple, bridges and connections that we use across different areas to make sure that we are working together and not just within the university, but we also reach out across as well. So many of us have joined projects with professionals across different parts of the country and also different parts of the world. So the idea again, just because we are here in Milwaukee, just because we are here in UWM, just because we may be here in Marquette, does not mean that our worldview is restricted within our school, with our college, within our discipline, but we think broadly. And, you know, we are really working on making sure that at every level that we are infusing and infusing data science and permeating it in our coursework and making sure that we reach across. So Dr. Boyd, you have been working on a lot of initiatives in this area as well. So
just, I don't want to, you know, we have a limited time. I'll just say briefly, like to sort of maybe put a more specific point on the interdisciplinarity, students are very interested, students and funding agencies are very interested right now in social justice and climate change, sustainability type topics. So you know, and actually talking about a Milwaukee focus too. So we there's a lot of different opportunities for students and for researchers to look, to turn their eye towards local problems and to try to use data science techniques, challenges and opportunities, right? To looking at local challenges and opportunities and trying to really improve our community using these tools. And it also partly in hopes that, you know, that students would, most of our graduates stay in Southeastern Wisconsin. So the idea is that we would not only train these students on, you know, abstract data science problems in, you know, somewhere in the world, but really turn our lens to the local community in a lot of cases. And then the graduates would then come into the local community and continue to work on those issues. So.
I think one thing that we're trying to do at Marquette in response to some of that feedback from other faculty and students is something that was mentioned, I think, earlier with UWM's program on data analytics, which I think is really exciting, is how do we provide an opportunity for students that may not have a strong STEM or coding background to still participate and engage in data science in meaningful and ways that help improve them. So, you know, we launched a minor recently that was meant to have both a STEM and a non-STEM kind of pathway to success. For doing that, we've introduced a data science course that I've co-taught into our core curriculum, which is meant for first or second year students university-wide to just come in and learn about data science and really just data literacy and some of those kinds of issues. You know, we're looking at avenues of how do we get PhD students across colleges to take some data science courses. So whether or not they're going into linguistics or political science or communication, that they have some of those kinds of skills. So finding those kinds of avenues as well. And then again, even with industry interactions and how do we make sure that the work that our engineering folks are doing around AI and machine learning, you know, is interfacing well with the work that we're doing or the work that's happening in nursing or these other places. So again, I think it sounds like both of our institutions are at this moment where we're trying to figure out the right way to kind of grow this in a way that also helps serve the community and serve the business needs out there.
And another thing, I think last year Marquette surveyed the data science related faculty and made a directory of all faculty members, and they arranged those faculty members according to the shared methodologies, but also according to the shared applications. I think that directory would be very helpful for example, for graduate students to form their committees. They can pick people who apparently are from a completely different department, but share very similar research interests and perspectives in the applications of data science. And I can copy and paste that link.
That is wonderful. I will say that would have been helpful. When I did my dissertation research, I was using a method that my advisor had never used. And so luckily I had a committee member that was able to help, but had that not been a fortunate occurrence, you know, it's finding the resources to help learn what you need to learn. So Larry, I appreciate you sharing that. I also wanted to have you share your thoughts, because you're from the Department of Strategic Communication. And often when we see data science, we're used to seeing, you know, disciplines like computer science, math, and even business, because of the emphasis on statistics. What kinds of things are you seeing in the College of Communication in terms of responses from students to integrating data in the work that you're doing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. So several emerging areas in terms of interest. One is data storytelling and visualization, and also data journalism, because now we, at Marquette, we have a program called O'Brien Fellowship, and we have professional journalists who spend 1 year here in the program doing an in-depth project and teaching students. And from what I heard from the O'Brien Fellows is they really want to learn how to utilize data analytics in journalism. For example, how to get access to publicly available data sets and how to merge that with census data sets and maybe use some GIS to make maps and interactive data visualizations. So it's really focuses on the application side of data science. And another area, I guess, is a lot of students are interested in that is predictive modeling in social media from reach, engagement, and conversion in digital marketing, because a lot of students, they will be pursuing their careers in that direction. So social media analytics has become a really big thing in our college.
Yeah, excellent. Great examples. So data is integrated in, you know, maybe majors that we would not have traditionally thought of. But it, again, speaks back to all the interdisciplinarity that you've all been mentioning. So I would love if you all could share some examples of things that you're doing in these classes, whether it's specific tools you're working with, projects you're having the students do. How is data science getting infused into the teaching in these programs right now? And let's start, since I just had Marquette talk a little extra, let's start with our reps from UWM on this one.
It's so hard to answer that because there's so many examples. Maybe sort of looking ahead, I'll just say we're organizing for our Bachelor of Science Data Science majors next semester an internship course in which our internship coordinator, Professor Larson, has actually reached out to some local businesses, and I'm not sure if I'm allowed to say, so maybe I won't say specifics, but he's made some contacts at local businesses and gotten actual problems for the students to work on. So students will be working in groups, and like basically they'll be consultants, right, in this internship class, working on these projects, and then they'll be reporting back to the clients. I mean, that sort of thing has happened also in the statistical hub that our colleague Razia has organized, but in a more broader context. But these will be specifically, you know, this is a very, workforce training. You know, this is a very concrete application. Students are be working on not some theoretical problem, but an actual problems that local companies are hiring them. We're giving them credit, but, you know, hiring them to solve, and then the students will be able to report back to the clients. So I think that's a really great example. And then there's lots of big and small examples in other contexts. But I'll let other people answer, and then I'll circle back if I feel like adding more. But
From the application side, there are plenty of examples. I'll just name a few from the marketing and supply chain folks at the business school, at the Lubar School of Business, from Dr. Papatla, Purush Papatla, who is co-director for the Northwestern Mutual DSI, NMDSI. He is leading a number of projects at various levels, from master students to the PhD students, and also working with the partners here at NMDSI. Things that really speak to the urgency and currency of some of the things that we have talked about, but really intersecting again through the social justice equity lenses. We have also from the, again, marketing information technology sides, Dr. Atish Sinha, Dr. Amit Bhatnagar, quite a few of those folks are working in this different types of projects, marketing based or other kind of based, that use a lot of things speak to solving those real world problems. Again, students are working on those projects. They are getting the data from different sources and they're using that as part of the project that are being used to teach them the skills, but also seeing the impact of those skills in making those data-driven decisions. And a couple of other colleagues, Dr. Tim Haas, he has been doing this for a number of years, really active in the conservation world, worldwide, WWF and a couple of other agencies using data from a variety of sources, the big data machine learning kind of approaches, tools, if you will, to solve some of those problems, or at least provide an input in terms of the insights where you can use to figure out where do you put your resources when conservation efforts are pretty resource rich in terms of, or resource hungry, let's put it this way. Where do you put those limited resources to work to have the biggest impact? He has been doing a lot of work with a variety of agencies and some of that he shares in classes, and Dr. Leith Alwyn as well, a variety of projects that he's been doing and putting that into practice in the classes. Again, the students are being taught to hone these skills with using real data and seeing the impact as they have those revelations, that they have this epiphanies. So this is how my skills are going to help me make better decisions and also help other folks as well. And from the world of HR from which I come, we are using people analytics. Mostly some of my projects are with my PhD students and also with other colleagues. And we're really helping to use data. We have been using data for making decisions, people analytics kind of decisions for years, but now we are very actively using some of those with our PhD students as well. So just a little bit from my world over here from the business school world. And Dr. Boyd, I don't know if you'd like to share some examples as well.
I mean, I think we should let our colleagues at Marquette probably respond to the question. But yeah, there's too many to list. You've already listed a lot. And actually, I've heard Tim Haas talk about the conservation efforts in Africa. And it's fascinating. But anyway, I'll let them go.
Yeah, I think we have a similar story. There are a lot of different spaces where data science is emerging. It's become one of the pillars that the university is looking strategically. You know, how do we move forward, and data science being an opportunity for campus to work across schools and colleges. And we have task forces to figure out, you know, how to make this happen. And I think it's one of the real benefits of the NMDSI is giving us that framework to start thinking about bringing data science into, I guess, non-traditional fields or fields that you don't think of, you know, immediately when that comes to mind. So like next week, I'm hosting a conversation on this topic. How do we bring data science into classrooms that normally wouldn't have it? And I'm having Dr. Amber Wachowski in political science. And she has this electorator project, which brings data science into her field, and Dr. Nate Lemoyne, who's in biological sciences and uses data science in his ecology research. And I'm an ethicist and I work within data science and doing with these things. So we're finding all these really interesting avenues to try to get data science into more and more parts of our curriculum.
All right, no shortage of good examples of things going on. Again, it's nice to hear, and it brings things to life a little more too. You know, we talk about this is a high demand field and students need these skills. Well, what do these skills look like when they're put into application? And just again, so many interesting things. I'm very curious about the conservation stuff. That sounds particularly cool. So in that previous discussion, the subject of internships came up. And so I want to talk a little bit about, you know, as students get later into the curriculum in particular, and they're getting ready to graduate and prepare for that next step. So what are the kinds of things that you're either currently doing or perhaps exploring doing for some of the newer programs to prepare students for jobs and things that they're going to be doing beyond graduation? And let's start with Marquette on this one.
I think I can share that I feel that in the future, we will have to more seamlessly integrate our classroom time and the online resources, because it's unrealistic to teach everything in the classroom. Our time is really limited. We can't just teach the basics of data science, but we have other better ways to do that. The students can choose to enroll in online programs, they can get those certificates, and they can use their free time to see those step-by-step tutorials. And the class time is really saved for us to better brainstorm the possibilities and talk about the big picture. So I think that's certainly one of the trends, which means that, and by the way, I do believe that a lot of online classes, they outperform what we can do in the classroom, because it's just a more efficient way to teach data analytics. You can integrate like animations and all kinds of things they can usually do something within 20 minutes, but for a regular class, it's probably 2 hours. So I think that's one of the directions to go.
And I think in terms of, internships and how we placing students. I mean, of course, like with UWM, we're lucky to be able to work with Northwest Mutual and have students, engage in that internship program and other industries in the area. And I think one of our paths forward, our new co-director, the Data Science Institute at Marquette, Scott Rex, that's one of his main initiatives, is to increase sort of the internship pipeline and relationships for our students to be able to get that kind of hands-on experience. We've had good success with a lot of our computing students, but building that out beyond some of the other disciplines that are engaged to make sure they get that kind of real world hands-on.
I'll put a plug for the Lubar School of Business. We are big in terms of preparing folks for internships. So beyond just having, anecdotal information or anecdotal stories on how to be a good intern and how to get the maximum advantage out of your internship, we really have classes that prepare you. It's one credit course that has now been made mandatory for all business school students there. And the idea is that make your internship experience count for you and work for you to your own advantage. So this is something that really helps people to polish up their resume, polish up their interviewing skills, polish up their LinkedIn profiles, polish up how they frame their experiences that they've had, because some of them may be working multiple jobs, may not yet have had a chance to have a formal professional internship. How do you put this all together to make yourself very attractive to your future employer, whether it's for a job or for an internship? So we are really putting a lot of emphasis in preparing our students who are coming from a lot of diverse backgrounds. Some of them may be first generation college going students who may lack the role models to know what it takes to be a successful intern or a successful employee. An intern is an employee for a short period of time and may not have this kind of a stature of an employee. So we're really starting from the ground up and making a huge impact. And of course, along with Northwestern Mutual, DSI, we are really fortunate to have, Mark has been, shout out to Mark from NM, who has been sharing internship opportunities specifically in these areas, in data science, data analytical kind of areas. But we also partner with a lot of organizations, not just in Milwaukee, but across the country, who send us their openings for hiring our interns, because, our graduates, when they move out to different leadership positions out of UWM, they are the ones who say, hey, do you have some good folks to recommend? So internships has always been huge for us, and it's only growing in importance.
Maybe I'll just sort of pull it back to another aspect that I pulled out of the question, and that was, in class time, sort of how you're structuring your class. So I don't know if people in the audience have this vision of professors at the university is standing at the board lecturing, but we don't actually do that so much anymore. And actually Larry was talking about this, having the students really be active in class time. And several of our related courses are taught at computer labs like we have a MATLAB Sci license. I mean, of course R is free, so we put R everywhere. So that students in a lot of our courses, we tend to do, we call it active learning, right? They tend to be very active in class time. We can easily it's sort of interesting in higher education, there's a lot of talk about, you know, everyone had to learn to teach online very suddenly, and a lot of people did it very badly, but, you know, we still learned a lot of sort of tricks and techniques. And I think now that we're mostly back in person, we're sort of trying to take the best of both worlds, right? So we have through our learning management system, we can post a lot of videos and information and online discussion groups, even for face-to-face classes that might meet in a computer lab. So students can have a personal interaction with their instructor if they wish to do so. Or most of our general assignment classrooms are equipped with lecture capturing capabilities, so students can view the class from home later. So we're trying to deliver this, our curriculum, to the students, and everyone learns in a little different way. So, you know, in a variety of formats, using a variety of techniques, and also incorporating more things like projects and teamwork, right, into a lot of courses. So, you know, that we know that, I mean, except for actuarial science majors who are going to be taking all these exams, you know, most of our students aren't going to take exams after they leave us. So why assess them? Why grade them based on exams? So more of our courses are having projects as their, you know, major assignments, and different students have different things to bring to a team. So it can be difficult when you're trying to grade a group project, but, you know, those difficulties are certainly smaller than the rewards that you get from having students learn to work together in the team project. So I think that's some sort of pedagogical, I'd say, aspects of how I think we're preparing students, even before, you know, an internship is great. They land an internship, great, right? But what are you doing before that to prepare them? And, you know, how are you sort of infusing the right kind of mindset in all of your classes? That's through this active learning, group projects and teamwork, and opportunities for presentations and of the work that you do. So I know that science majors can be, you know, what do you mean we have to, you know, I want to learn how to solve the problems. Like, well, you're going to have to explain it to somebody. Sorry. So, you know, make a PowerPoint, explain this to me, explain, you know, you're going to have a presentation on this topic. Even in math classes, we have to do some of the classes have to do presentation because it's, you know, communication. You know, these soft skills are just so important.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. Again, it all seems to come back down to the interdisciplinary piece. You know, you still need a little bit of those areas outside of your area of expertise, to your point. You've got to be able to communicate. Great examples shared by all of you. I also appreciate, in particular, that you brought up some issues like, you know, barriers for students who are, you know, needing to go through these things like internships, but they maybe have, you know, gotten a delayed start because their schedule's been filled with multiple jobs, and making sure they're learning the things that they need to interview effectively and get those positions. So I'm glad you shared that. And I also wanted to just echo that the different methods of learning in different environments on the corporate side, think about how we all had to pivot, you know, everyone working remotely during the pandemic and being able to communicate in different formats, collaborate in different ways. I think that adaptability, so knowing that they're experiencing that adaptability in the classroom is really important, because it is something that they will certainly experience in the workplace as we all have. So let's look forward a little bit further. As you look down the road over the next few years, where do you see things going in terms of data science education? And let's start with Marquette on this one.
I wish that were easy to answer. I do think we've been kind of teasing it this whole conversation, and I think it's finding that interdisciplinary mix, finding the right balance of offerings that are both for those interested in a more technical and analytical approach in terms of how data science works and why it works, and wanting to really, you know, dive into that aspect of it. But then also those that are looking for just skills in analytics and making sense of data and how to report out and how to make decisions and build decision support systems. And sort of, you know, bridging that gap. And then I think even one of the questions that I saw in the Q&A is even finding applications, not just cross disciplines, like within the university and how we approach teaching students, but crossing sectors of industry. And that, you know, there might be obvious applications within, within healthcare or within finance or insurance, but how do we apply within supply chain or other management or other manufacturing and other domains, and making sure that our programs are responsive to those other demands. And I think we're meeting that, but that I think is the direction, at least that I see from where we sit.
Yeah, I think data science will become more every day. It's been normalized. So just like everyday design, the logic, it's becoming something that really focuses on decision-making, and it should be human-centered, and it should be ethically driven. And instead of focusing on data, we focus on people. I think that's the future.
If I may, I'll piggyback off of Larry's comment. I think it's in the pursuit of using data-driven decision-making, a lot of organizations that provide data that work with the backend in terms of using different types of algorithms, they are having to step back a little bit and evaluate the process that they're using for making these data-driven decisions, because somewhere down the line, the ethics has been lost. Many of you may have seen the documentary that has really had a very profound impact on the way we look at this profession, the Coded Bias documentary, which really exposed some of those hidden biases that we have not even taken time to evaluate. So this is something that is going to be a bigger part of our conversation as we start to look at using data to make decisions more and more in everything that we are doing, from healthcare to where we get our mortgages, to what kind of cars we buy, where we live, everything. So every aspect of our life is going to be data driven, if you will. That's the future. The question is, how can we make it as ethical and as equitable as possible, and keeping it as transparent too, because that goes into emphasizing the ethics.
I'll just add. So I was talking about the importance of soft skills and teamwork and in courses, and actually our new degree programs, the Bachelor of Science in Data Analytics and the Master of Science in Data Science, require a data ethics course. Also, for those of you that love panels, on October 15th, our department, along with the WISCAMP Scholars Program at UWM, is going to be sponsoring a data ethics panel on using data wisely to help communities of color, what you need to know. There'll be Nadia Johnson from the Milwaukee Way Tech Hub, who some of you might know, Crystal Tsotsi, who's a PhD candidate in genomics and health disparities at Vanderbilt University, and her work is with Indigenous peoples and data, mostly in healthcare. And then Noel Chesley, who's an associate professor at UWM and founder of Tech Health. I think there's going to be a follow-up communication from this panel session. I sent the information to Michelle, and I'll ask her to send it to you guys in case you're interested in that. It's part of the whole October month Milwaukee Tech that I think the Milwaukee Tech Hub is helping to coordinate. So you may have seen about this already, but if you want to dive a bit deeper into data ethics, because for sure that's definitely increasingly important, then that would be a good place to start. So.
Yeah, I think this is a vital point. One of the things that I'm proud of on how Marquette's approaching data science is that ethics and social justice are at the core. It fits our mission as a Catholic Jesuit university. So the data ethics class that I teach is required for all of our data analytics programs, whether you're in business analytics, accounting analytics, healthcare, criminal justice, or our data science programs within computer science, you have to take that class and engage with that. And it's just what everyone's been saying. We'll be putting out our announcement too, so to plug a second event after the great one that Dr. Boyd mentioned on November 4th. We'll be holding the 6th annual Marquette Ethics of Big Data Symposium. We'll have details out on that in the next week or so.
I think we have too many programs. I think our Bachelor of Science Data Science also requires an ethics course. We have too many programs in the same track of, but yeah, they're all there.
I think the main takeaway that I'm getting is everyone should really watch their email for this follow-up message, because it's going to be very, very resource rich, and there's going to be lots of great stuff to keep engaging. My last question before we open it up to audience Q&A is, what, you know, if, let's say data science professionals are interested in getting involved with your work at the university. How can we help? What else can we do? And I'll open, anyone can answer. This
one's open for him. Come to us. That's a one word answer or three word answer.
Can you repeat it? Sorry. What?
I said, reach out to us.
Yeah, I would love, I mean, we would love more. Students often use sort of toy examples or public source data information. Like if you have a, something that you're allowed, that you feel comfortable sharing with us, you know, so either feedback, like, please do more of this, or like, hey, here's a problem that we're working on that we're not in a hurry for it to be solved. But you know, maybe your students could hack away at it and come up with something, you know, over the period of the next few months, right? Any kind of, you know, or here's a problem that we already solved, but like, we'll give you the problem, but not the solution. Give it to your students and see what they can make of it. Right. You know, any kind of either suggestions like graduates, we'd like our graduates to really know this, you know, here's some stuff that you can do. You could reach out to Michelle and she can get the information to us, or you can reach out to us directly if you have our contact information. I don't know if that was distributed, but yeah, we would just love. I mean, we're trying to guess what you want, right? So we would just love your feedback.
We can definitely make sure everyone's contact pages are included in the follow-up email so that people can reach out.
One quick note is that in addition to things that Dr. Boyd mentioned, you know, sometimes it becomes a issue of sharing proprietary information, whether it is the problem that they've solved and best practices. We see this as a kind of you can couch it in a way that you strip it of the identifying information and still give us some bare bones, again, as a way to have students cut their teeth or at least try to explore the solution space a little bit, and then have presentations, be part of the presentation so that you can work with the students and be mentors to them. So mentorship is one way to get involved, whether it is with the use of data or mentorship through actually talking to folks who are starting in this profession and they want to know what it's really like to be an employee or to be a data scientist or data-driven decision maker in different organizations. But also really inspiring generations of students by sharing your own pathways, by coming to our classes, by having these kind of panel discussions, by really motivating them to explore people who may not have looked at this field as a way for them to really learn about, you know, how data science can really be useful for whatever they're doing, because as we all mentioned, there's nothing that is going to remain untouched by data science or data analytics. So make it a little more inviting. And the only way that can happen, or one of the big ways that it can happen, is by having professionals who can share part of their journeys and say how they got involved with that. And, you know, shout out to you, Michelle, you've shared your journey with us in some of the forums and it's really been inspiring. So these are the kind of things that we have been really, really looking forward to engaging with the professionals who may be a little hesitant in sharing data, but we can at least have those inspirational stories. We can have inspirational journeys as well as very active internships and mentorships.
Maybe I'll just add that, like, this can be, you don't have to have something that you think was like super, super fancy. I mean, even just like, you know, data is always messy, right? Like how do you, you're trying to, understand the demographics of people in some, you know, some particular clientele or like whatever. I need to figure out, like, how do I put this in Excel? How do I format this? How do I make sense of this? Like, what do I store? What do I do when some data points are missing? Like, even just data collection and, you know, formatting, like just to start, that can be hard to do, right? You don't have to have some, you know, here's what we need to do, and then here's how we ended up doing it. That can be valuable for students. It doesn't have to be like, oh, we used TensorFlow to find this very complicated answer. It's a very complicated question. Like, it doesn't have to be like that. So really, and we have these even though we have all these with a sophomore level quantitative literacy requirement, and there's all these sort of statistics and research methods classes all across campus. And we would love to incorporate some kind of experiential learning and data science opportunity into as many as possible of them, but that would require some, and that's not going to be the students who haven't even had much basic stats yet, right? So that's not going to be super advanced, but it would be getting them to see like, oh, here's how data might be collected and used in this context, and here's something that you can do to help understand it. So even that would be valuable. And we can of course make these things up, but like anything that we can actually connect to the local community, even if it's with like Dr. Singh said, with data that was cleaned up or what's the word, retracted? What do they do when they redacted?
Redacted, stripped out. Yeah.
When they take names off of it and things like that, would be great.
So that's a really great segue into an audience question that I have. It's for these interdisciplinary projects. Are students typically using open source public data, or are they doing research or collection to develop their own? And what advice would you have about data collection and consumption for somebody who's wanting to practice this?
In most of our courses, our students tend to be finding public data sets, and it's either, there's platforms like Kaggle where there's data sets made available there, and there's public government data sets that are available. Even honestly on Reddit, there's r/datasets, and that's where you can find all kinds of things. And I think the caution, and I've actually had a case where an instructor came to me because a student found a data set that surprisingly had some personally identifiable information on it. And we had to find an avenue for the student to either make use of that data set or find an alternate source, because we just didn't want to put a student in that kind of ethical situation that they had to struggle with the fact that there appeared to be social security numbers or stems of social security numbers in that data set, which really shouldn't have been there at all. And that turned into a teaching moment right there in terms of how we gather data and make it publicly available. So that's the kind of things that we tend to be seeing. I don't know if any of the others had other experiences.
We use publicly available data as much as possible. At the same time, we also collect our own data. So it's both. And part of the question that was asked here is, what advice would you give? This is the advice that I give to everybody. And I also remember it for myself in terms of what is it that I want to find out? What is that I'm trying to understand? Because the data, again, is a tool. What questions am I trying to answer? What problem am I trying to solve? The data that you collect, or the data that you seek out, or the way you analyze it, or the information that you glean out of it, a lot of it will depend on what is it that you're trying to find out. So one approach would be very clear in terms of what is it that you're trying to solve, and be as open to revising those questions and being open to what the data tells you, the story, so that you're not trying to force fit into a kind of a predetermined notion. Because I will not use the quote that has always been said about statistics and things like that. You can frame it any which way to tell any kind of a story. So a lot of data science, data analytics is also storytelling. And what story do you want to tell? What aspect do you want to highlight? What insights do you want to glean out of it? It comes from the questions that you're trying to answer and problems you're trying to solve. So be clear about that and be open.
Another thing I would like to add is I think we should probably closely work with IRB, at least inform IRB what's going on, because data science is a very, in terms of data collection, a lot of things have been debated. For example, is that legal or not legal, or ethical or not ethical to scrape a certain website? I think a lot of times students just do it anyway, but the instructors are responsible for making sure that it's consistent with, at least with the IRB protocols, because we've seen cases in which people get into trouble.
I would add, but I think we're basically out of time. I mean, I know that Michelle has a couple of closing remarks.
Talk fast. Go ahead, add your point.
One example is the other thing. So there's some examples where we look at, there's publicly available data has a wide variety of meanings. So actually we have some institutional data that you can get sort of if you have a UWM email address and access, right? So we have an Office of Institutional Assessment Research. The IRB is that I think it's something about Institutional Review Board, right? But this, but we sometimes have students like in basic stats classes get grade data. So you can get data on what were all the grades assigned by every professor in the last like several semesters in every class. And then you can have them, you know, discover some patterns and calculate some things, right? So and that's been really interesting during the pandemic too, to then compare like calculate pass rates, standard deviations, and whatever other statistical measures and calculate and compare to the past and enrollment patterns. And anyway, you can, there's some, so I was talking about us sort of looking our lens in Milwaukee, but we're also taking our lens and looking at our own institution and how can we actually harness the intelligence and creativity of our own and efforts of our own students to improve things, using data science here at UWM. So that's another example of a data source that we might use is internal institutional data without names, of course, right? De-identified.
Yeah, excellent. Excellent examples once again, all. All right, so we are coming up on the end of the hour. I do have a quick final two announcements that I want to share before we wrap up. So first is Northwestern Mutual is running our summer internship program again. And so we are accepting applications now for the summer 2022 internship program. There's multiple different positions within core data and analytics. And so October 15th is the priority deadline for first round of candidate review. So if you are a student interested or you know students who are interested, please share the information on my screen. There's a URL. Again, we'll include information in the follow-up email as well. But we would love good intern applicants for summer because we love our interns. And then last thing I want to share is looking forward to our next session in October. Again, you will get that very resource-rich follow-up email. We would appreciate you filling out our survey to provide feedback on this session and help us inform future sessions. But then join us for our October session with Gary Cow, Vice President of Analytics at Akron Children's Hospital. The topic will be about building an enterprise data mindset, which I think will be another great conversation. So more information to come. If you want to stay up to date, make sure you go to nmdsi.org and sign up to be included on the distribution list if you're not already. And once again, huge, huge thank you to our tremendous panelists today. Wonderful discussion, great examples. I learned so much from all of you and I hope our audience did too. Thank you all again for joining us today and have a great afternoon.